Relations that all harmonize so beautifully together. There has to be a God, there has to be a creator, amen? Well, tonight, get your Bible if you would. And we're going to open our Bibles. We're going to do a little study tonight in the book of Genesis. But just as a jumping off point tonight, let's get our Bibles and turn to Romans. The book of Romans, chapter 1. The book of Romans, chapter 1. I want you to notice a passage here in Scripture, just as sort of a place for us to begin tonight. Romans, chapter 1. The Bible says in verse 18, it says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men." I want you to notice the phrase here, "who hold the truth." Who hold the truth in unrighteousness. And then I want you to notice the Bible says in verse 20, back to verse 19, the Bible says, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them." And then it goes on to say, "For God hath showed it unto them." You know, God has revealed some things to us. There's some things that God has made known as to mankind. What has he made known? Well, verse 20, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by what? By the things that are made." You know, science is a wonderful thing. Because science, the whole purpose of it is to discover, to ask questions, to try to find out the how and the why and the where. And so true science is never in conflict with our Bibles. Amen? The Word of God and true science have no conflict whatsoever. There are those who would like to suggest that it's true, that there's a conflict between the two, but there's not. God has given us inquisitive minds. You remember the old saying, inquiring minds want to know? And that's really what lies at the root of all science, is people want to know, when did this happen? How did this happen? Why did this happen? And so as we investigate the creation, the Bible says here, very plainly here in the Word of God, it says the invisible things of him, of God, from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Let's ask the Lord's blessing upon the preaching of the Word of God tonight. Father, we thank you for the Bible. We thank you that it was given by divine inspiration. We thank you, dear God, that we can have our minds illuminated by your Spirit, and that we can understand spiritual things. And I pray, dear God, tonight that your Spirit would speak to us, you'd build us up in our faith. And I pray, Lord, that this message, Lord, would penetrate our hearts and establish us in our faith. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Amen. As you look at the history of mankind, there are really only two basic worldviews. One is that man is the center of everything, and that it's a man-centered view. Or the other view is that there's a God-centered view. Now, I understand there are many religions in the world, and so there are many different gods that are promoted in the world by different religions. But the bottom line is this: there either is a God or there's not a God. And you know, the Bible is very plain when it says the fool has said in his heart there is no God. In fact, intelligence would tell us that if we discover design, and particularly when you discover intricate design and complicated design, that there had to be a designer. Amen? And so to me, the reasonable mind and the rational mind would say there has to be a God. Now, people may speculate as to who that God is. I happen to believe that the God of creation is the God of the Bible. I believe in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and earth. That is the starting point. Now, I know that there are those who will come to us and say, well, where did God come from? And I will tell them that I have no explanation for that. God simply is the great I am. He always has been. He always will be. He is the eternal one. He is the one who is dependent upon no one and no thing. But the question I would ask the evolutionists and the materialists and the Carl Sagans of our day is this: where did matter come from? Because we may not have an explanation as to where God came from, but they have no explanation as to where matter came from. And their best explanation is the Big Bang Theory. And I think that's interesting. That's their theory. Now, many now today are disagreeing with the idea of the Big Bang Theory. Now, I have a biblical theory. It's called the Big Banger Theory. Amen? And the Big Banger was God. God is the one that spoke, and everything that did not exist came into existence. In fact, even in science, they call that ex nihilo. In other words, out of nothing. And that's really what they believe. They believe that matter came out of nothing. And really, as Christians, we believe the same thing. We believe that God is eternal, and that God, by his spoken word, created everything that we see. If you look in your Bible just for a moment, over the book of Hebrews, and we're going to go back to Genesis here in a moment, but look at Hebrews, a couple of verses I want you to take note of here. Look at Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1. Very important verse as we kind of get back into creation this evening. Hebrews chapter 1, where it talks about the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. I alluded a little bit to this verse this morning. But I want you to notice chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. The Bible says, "Hath in these last days has spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also," there's the phrase I want you to see, "by whom also he made the worlds." Jesus Christ. "By whom also he made the worlds." And I point this out before in my preaching on this subject, but do you realize it was not until the invention of the telescope that the world even knew there were worlds? I will guarantee you, when this Bible was written and everything in the New Testament was completed by 95 AD, the latest book is the book of Revelation. Hebrews was written many years before that. I will guarantee you that they did not have telescopes when the book of Hebrews was written. And so when they would observe Jupiter or Saturn, they had no idea that those were not the stars. But the Bible here, many years ahead of science, talks about there being worlds. The Bible says in this passage, it says, "by whom he made the worlds." Now you may wonder, well, preacher, why did God make it all? Why did he create it all? Well, look in your Bible at Revelation for a moment tonight. Revelation. I want to show you an interesting verse because this is a key verse on the subject of creation. Look in your Bible, if you would, at chapter 4, Revelation. Now here's the reason why you're here tonight. Not just here in this building, amen, but why you arrived on this planet called planet Earth. You ever ask yourself those questions when you were a kid growing up? I often wondered, why am I here? I didn't ask to be born, amen. And the question is, you know, not only why am I here, but where am I going? You ever think about that? Where are you going when you die? Because every one of us knows there's a first breath and a last breath. You ever ponder those questions in your life about where are you going? And then the question, why am I here? What's the purpose of life? Well, I think this verse is a wonderful verse that will answer some of those questions for us. The Bible says in verse 11, "Thou art worthy," speaking of the God of heaven, Jesus Christ, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power." Now look at the key here. "For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are, and they were created." Now, I don't know how you are, but when I begin to observe the many, many types of animal life and plant life and all the things that make up our planet, even geological life, I become very fascinated. I think it's beautiful, amen? I also like to chuckle a little bit at some of the explanations or some of the hypotheses of modern-day scientists with their theories. And many of them, they postulate as though they're fact. And the reality is, many of the things they're postulating about, they weren't there and neither was I. And so the reality is, they're nothing more than theories. They're not really based upon real science. Real science is based on observation. And you know, there's nothing wrong with drawing intelligent conclusions. But we need to understand that when man's hypothesis or theories come in conflict with God's word, then we must do, as the Bible says, "Let God be true and every man a liar." And I know the Bible does not give the explanation for everything in the world. The Bible is not a science book, and I think we need to understand that. But when the Bible speaks in observational scientific statements, they are always accurate. That's the thing that's amazing about the Bible. For instance, centuries before modern microbiology, centuries before they understood the nature of the blood, the Bible says the life of the flesh is in the blood. Now you think about the number of centuries of human history that passed before the advent of the modern microscope and where they discovered the real nature of blood and how the blood is the life of our flesh. We got the Bible saying that centuries before, not based on the fact that scientists had discovered it, but it was simply a statement of inspiration. The life of the flesh is in the blood. And of course, we know that was discovered. Think about the centuries that man believed that the world was flat. And yet the Bible says, "He that sitteth upon the circle of the earth." And that word "circle" in the Hebrew language literally means a sphere, just like our planet is. And so the Bible taught us that the world was round long before scientists had come to that conclusion. In fact, think about even the days of Christopher Columbus in the 1400s. Many people still believe the earth was a big pancake, amen? And if you went too far, you would fall off. And of course, we know that that's not true. And you know, you think about just simple observation. Christopher Columbus, as he would watch ships sail, he noticed that the bottom of the ship would begin to disappear, but you could still see the mast. That taught him something about the shape of the earth, amen, that the earth was round. But his first discovery of the earth being round was from Scripture, amen, that the Bible speaks of the earth as being a sphere, being a globe, not simply a flat surface. And so the Bible has been centuries ahead of science, though it is not a science book. It's been centuries ahead of science. Now, if we can trust the Bible for past things where scientists were wrong, why is it we have such a struggle today when scientists come up with their theories and then they promote them as though they are fact or provable fact, when in fact they're not provable facts? They're nothing more than man's theories. And we know, of course, that all of man's theories are not correct, because we've found, as you study history, there are many things that people believe in the medical community and the biological community that due to advances in science they no longer believe today. Well, I still believe in creation. I still believe there's a creator, don't you?
Amen.
God is the one that created the heavens and the earth. And as we look at the work of creation, let's go back in our Bibles into Genesis 1, and we'll consider a couple of days the work of creation. Now, Jesus taught us that the earth was created in 6 literal days. And so he believed in the Pentateuch. He believed in the Bible and the Bible's record of the creation of everything that has life. Now, what's interesting is when God created the world, everything is interdependent. There's an interdependence among everything. In fact, we call that the balance of nature. And God himself is the one that created that balance of nature. And so that is one reason why we reject the day-age theory, that some have promoted the idea that each of these days may have been a reality millions of years. Of course, we reject that view. We reject the gap theory, the idea that somehow there was a gap between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. No, we take the Bible literally, that God did what he did in a reasonably short period of time. In fact, the word days that is used in Genesis 1 is the same word used for days in other places in the Hebrew that refer to specific days. And so there's no reason for us to believe that these days were represented by millions of years. And you say, well, why would you believe that, preacher? Because everything within the creation is dependent upon each other. And so you have plant life that is dependent upon insect life. You have all different types of interdependency within the created work of God. And so because of that, some things could not have existed for millions of years without those things that were created on other days within God's work of creation. So let's just take God's word for what it says. Let's take it for what it says. Now, we looked at the different days. Day 1 spoke of unity, and that was the creation of light itself. And then day 2 was the separation of the land masses from the waters that took place. Day 3, of course, God himself, the only source of light on this day. We see that God brought forth plant life, and we talked about that before. Today we want to move into day 4. Let's get our Bibles and look at chapter 1, verse 14 of the book of Genesis. Chapter 1, verse 14. The Bible says, "And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years." Now, you think about the faithfulness of God. From the beginning of creation, we've had seasonal changes that always take place. And I hear people make this statement. They'll say, well, when it's really warm in the winter, they'll say, well, doesn't the Bible teach that we won't be able to tell one season from another? That's not in the Bible. That's someone's idea from the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible does that have anything to do with prophecy. The reality is, from the beginning of time, God promised. In fact, when the flood was over, God promised his faithfulness to Noah and said that as long as the earth continues, there will be those seasons. Those seasons. And of course, you know that's true. We had a cold winter. We had a lot of snow this past year. But you know something? Springtime, though it arrived late, it come. Amen? We had about 90 degrees this week, so I would say that summer has arrived. Amen? And so these seasonal changes have continued, and they've continued year after year, your whole life. And you know, you think about not only your life, but for the time that the earth was created, God created these seasonal changes. And I don't know about you, but I kind of like them. Amen. I know some people want to move to Tahiti, but I enjoy the change of the seasons. I enjoy going to Florida once in a while, but I wouldn't want to live there because I enjoy, and I know you cringe when I said this, but I enjoy seeing the snow come down. Amen. I enjoy that. Now, I get tired of it around February, amen, and I'm ready for springtime like you are, but I enjoy the beauty of what God has created, and all of the seasons are at the hand of God. There's a purpose for all of it. Well, as you look at God's word here, the Bible says, let there be light. So we're going to talk about the creation of these sources of light. The number 4 in the Bible is generally connected with the earth and with creation in the word of God. There are four directions. There is north, south, east, and west. There are four seasons, spring and summer, fall and winter. The Bible speaks of the four winds of the heavens, Revelation 7, 1 to 3. There are four tides, each 24-hour period, two incoming and two outgoing. You know that even the waves of the sea are perfectly timed? They are perfectly timed. If you will time the waves, in fact, they are actually now using tidal surge and waves to produce power. We were just driving across Ontario, and I thought we had a lot of windmills out here off Highway 65 up near Monticello. When we drove across Ontario, all the way from Windsor, clear down to the Niagara City, on the other side of Ontario, there were windmills the entire way. I mean, more windmills than I've ever seen before. They're almost, it's almost euphoric when you drive across there and see those huge wind generators. Well, you think about the number four is connected to the planetary bodies. There are four bodies connected to creation. There's the earth, the sun, the stars, the moon, and the planets. The tides themselves, incoming and outgoing. This is all a part of God's plan. In fact, the Bible says that God set a decree for the sea. And what that means is that God is the one because of his laws. And our founders called them the laws of God and the laws of nature's God. As they observed these physical laws of the universe. For instance, all of your laws of thermodynamics, the laws of physics. Those are laws that are observational. And that have been understood by man. Some great scientific minds, like Isaac Newton, understood those and was the one that first wrote about, like, gravity and so forth. And so these laws, God himself, when he created the world, these are the physical laws of the universe that God himself created. There are four things connected to man, to God's creation, that were destroyed by the great flood. Mankind was destroyed, the beasts of the earth, the creeping things, and the fowls of the air. It's interesting when God created the Garden of Eden that there were four heads of the river that flowed in the Garden of Eden in Genesis 2, 8 through 10. Now the work of creation on the fourth day, on the first day of creation, God, through his light, brought light into his creation by the words, "Let there be light." He then separated the light from the darkness and created day and night. And then on the fourth day of creation, he said, "Let there be lights." It was on this day that God created the sources of heat and light as we know them. Let's look at it here in the Word of God. The Bible says, "And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven." Now you know that the firmament speaks of the atmosphere that we can observe. If you look stretched out from one horizon to the other horizon, you look at that starscape or that skyscape during the day, that is the firmament. That is the place, that is the atmosphere in which we live. In fact, scripturally, that is the first heaven. There are three heavens in the Bible. There's the first heaven, that is this atmosphere that we are breathing. Now, the world is really worried about the hole in the ozone layer, and they're worried about the fact that we may all die from lack of oxygen, and of course, because of the destruction of the world by fossil fuels, and there's a lot of things that man is concerned about today. But the reality is that God is the sustainer of the universe. I'm not saying we should wantonly destroy this earth, because God did not give it to us to destroy. He gave it to us to have dominion over and for us to use for our good and for his glory. And I think there is some wanton destruction of our planet that should not be going on. But nevertheless, God is the one that's going to sustain the world and as long as he desires to sustain it. And never forget that it's going to end not with a flood, the second heaven, but one with fire. And the Bible is very plain about that in the book of Peter. Now, as you look then at God's Word here, we find that there are four things connected to God's creation that were destroyed by the great flood. But then as we look at the work of creation, he separated the light from the darkness. And on this fourth day of creation, God said, "Let there be lights." It was on this day that God created the sources of heat and light as we know them. Now, on a hot day, we may not necessarily appreciate the heat of the sun. You ever get in your car when it's 95 or 100 degrees out and you get in there and it's like nothing? My son, when he served in Iraq, told me, and of course, you know, the temperatures were unbelievable there. But when they began those hummers in Iraq, when the temperature outside was 115 degrees, he said it was like climbing into an oven when you climbed into a hummer that had been parked there in Iraq. So we may not appreciate all the time the heating power of the sun. It is a powerful heat source. But I want to talk a little bit about the sun, about the stars, to give you some things to kind of get it in perspective for you. Why did God create light on the first day and then wait to create the sources of light until the fourth day? Here's why. Because God himself is light. The Bible says God is light and in there is no darkness at all. One day, when there is a new heaven and new earth, the Bible says they'll have no need of the sun or the moon or the stars because Jesus Christ himself will be the light thereof. Amen? And so God himself is light. He is the very source of light itself. Now, why did God create light on the first day? Well, here's some thoughts tonight. Perhaps earth itself was created first to demonstrate that it would be the focal point of his eternal plan and purpose. Also, perhaps to prevent man from worshiping the heavenly bodies. By the way, from the beginning of time, there have been people who worship the sun. In fact, down in Egypt, the country of Egypt, at the time when the Israelites were taken captivity down there, they worshiped the sun god, Ra. There probably are people somewhere today in the world today that still worship the sun. In fact, I think we see some of them down at Miami Beach, amen, that are sun worshipers. But the reality is that there are people who worship the sun. I believe that God created light, or God was the essence of light before the sources, because God wanted man to see that those sources of light were not God. They were created by God. We are not to worship the creation. We are to worship the Creator who is blessed forever. Amen? Okay, so as you think about the subject of God created these later, now perhaps also then prevent man from worshiping the heavenly bodies of the sun, the moon, and the stars, and to demonstrate the life-giving light existed before the common sources of light. God himself is light, and he alone is to be worshipped. Now, on the fourth day, we observe the creation of four different classes of celestial bodies. Number one, the greater light, the sun, to rule the day. The sun. Now, think about these statistics about the sun. If the sun were hollow, 1,300,000 planets the size of Earth would fit inside. Did you get a hold of that? If the sun were hollow, 1,300,000 planets the size of Earth would fit inside. Now, the star Antares could contain 64 million of our suns. According to science and their discoveries of the celestial bodies, they said that the sun is actually a dwarf star. Now, you may ask, well, then why does it appear so large compared to other stars? Because of its closer proximity. Amen? It's only 93 million miles from Earth. And so, because of its proximity. Now, also think about this. Look at the fact that God created the Earth in the perfect amount of distance between the Earth and the sun. If we were closer to the sun, you know what would take place. You think we'd have global warming. It'd be global burning. Amen? By the way, just recently they had that big volcano down in Chile that actually erupted. I don't know if any of you saw the unbelievably beautiful videos of that. It was just unbelievable. In fact, some of the pictures were like watching the sunset with that volcano going off in the background. But according to scientists, I think it's interesting when you begin to read some of their observations, they said that volcanoes' effect on the climate is that they can cool the earth or they can heat it up. They don't know which. Now, from studying history, most of the time, major volcanic eruptions have actually caused a cooling of the earth's temperature. So, if you're worried about global warming, just pray for another volcano to erupt, amen? Because it cools the earth's temperatures. In fact, they say that year, I think it was 1816, when there was no summer at all. And that was actually a year with no summer. You ever read about that year? And there was no summer. They said that was actually caused as a direct result of volcanic eruptions that had taken place on the planet that year. So if you're worried about global cooling, well, God can take care of it. Amen. All God has to do is just cause a volcanic eruption, and he'll bring the temperature down. Now, another thing that I think is humorous is the fact that the scientists say that we're having the warmest years on record, okay? And they talk about climate change and all these things. And yet they'll say that the temperature of the earth is 1 degree warmer than it was 50 years ago. And I'm thinking, well, you know, I'm up on the top of a mountain. I'm at the North Pole and it's 33 below zero instead of being 32 below zero. The ice still isn't going to melt. Amen? So a lot of these things are man trying to play God. And the reality is God is still in control. Amen? Still in control of his universe and his creation. And so I don't think we should lay awake at night worrying. You know, I've read so many articles, and I've got a copy of National Geographic that's in my office in there, and they've got an entire section about the devastation that is going to take place in the United States with Yellowstone, which is one of the largest volcanic areas in our country, when it erupts. Well, you know something? I'm not laying in bed tonight worried about Yellowstone blowing up. Amen? Now, is it going to happen? It could happen. Okay? That may be a way that God brings judgment. I don't know whether it will be or not. But here's what I know. That if it goes off, I'm going up. Amen? And I know where I'm going. I know what my destiny is. I know I'm saved. So I'm not clinging tenaciously to this mud ball called earth. Amen? The reality is I'm blessed with it. I'm thankful for it. I enjoy the beauty of what God has created. Everything from the glacier fields that I've hiked through and the North Cascades, which I love to be out backpacking in the middle of that wilderness area. We were just filled with awe over Niagara Falls and the beauty of those falls, and just magnificent. I mean, I've never seen them before. I've been to many waterfalls, many places in America, but I've never been anything with the splendor and the grandeur of those falls. And I'm overwhelmed with them. I love the beauty of God's creation. But I need to understand that you need to understand tonight that we do not worship the creation, we worship the Creator. And so think about these bodies here. Now, we were talking about Antares. The star Antares could contain 64 million of our suns. In the constellation Hercules, there is a star so large that it could contain 100 million of Antares. That's a star, amen? If you look at these statistics, it's just astronomical. The largest known star is Epsilon, which could swallow several million of the large star in the constellation of Hercules. What I'm telling you is, when you think about this, it is awe-inspiring that God created all of this. The Bible says that He made the stars also. Now, the lesser lights will rule the night, the moon. It's also an amazing phenomenon that God has created. We know that the moon has no light of its own. All of the light from the moon is reflected light. When the earth comes directly in the path between the sun and the moon, or the earth, I should say, then there's a total lunar eclipse and it goes completely out. And I think the Bible is interesting when the Bible calls the moon God's faithful witness in heaven. I think it's a perfect picture of the believer. We have no light of our own. Amen? But we can reflect the light of the sun, the Lord Jesus. He is the sun. Amen? And the Bible even calls Him the Son of Righteousness that will arise with healing in His wings. And so I think about this. What's my job? I have no light. But Jesus told me, ye are the light of the world. He said, I am the light of the world, but He lives in me. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of power may be of God, none of us. So what light can I give you? I can only give you the light that's reflected from the sun, from Jesus. Amen? And so what's my job? My job as a Christian is to be a full moon, beaming out light into a world that is filled with darkness. And you know, you go out in the night that's a full moon, it's beautiful. Amen? I mean, it casts its glow everywhere. And so that's what God wants us to be. We're to be like His faithful witness in heaven. And so you think about the power of the moon, though. You think about the moon, a small planet that orbits the earth and receives all of its light in the form of reflected light. Now, if you ever observe the moon, it's covered with craters. There's far more craters on the moon than there is on earth. Okay? There's far more. Now, I've been to some areas of the world where there's large craters. In fact, up in northern Michigan, okay, there's a crater lake up there. There's one out in Oregon known as Crater Lake. And they're beautiful areas today. But the moon has far more. You say, why? Because the moon has a gravitational pull, and God created it to protect the earth from meteors and from asteroids. And actually, they are drawn toward it. It's like a protection for the earth. That's not by accident. God created it that way. And so it was created for that reason, to be a thing of protection. It's also, it is a gauge of our time. Amen? In fact, the term month comes from the phases of the moon. And every 30 days in our world, the moon goes through those phases. And of course, the word month is based upon that. When there's a full moon, people go a little loony. Amen? In fact, even law enforcement will tell you when there's a full moon, okay, it does affect human behavior. There is a rise in crime that is connected with the change in the phases of the moon. Now, you say, well, how can that be? Well, if the moon has enough power to cause the tides, and our body is also composed of a lot of water, maybe it has more effect on us than we realize. Amen? So, if your pastor goes loony, just blame it on the moon. Amen? And you'll know why. I went off the deep end. Now, you think about this, as we think about God's creation, and the moon itself is a wonder. And then the creation of the multitudes of stars, the creation of multitudes of stars that exist in the universe, the establishment of the orbits of all the planetary bodies. And you know, I'm still amazed over the watch and how man created watches. I've got some beautiful old pocket watches that actually belong to my grandfather's on both sides. And I love them. And sometimes I'll screw off the back and look at the mechanics in those watches, and I think someone designed that. And of course, those old time watches don't keep time nearly as well as a modern day. This watch I'm wearing now, my kids bought me as a Seiko, and it's actually solar powered, so I don't even have to put a battery in it. And it keeps nearly, as far as I can tell, perfect time. Think about the universe as God's perfect timepiece. Now, we would not want to even believe for a minute that a watch just came as a result of an explosion. Why would we believe the universe, that is God's perfect timepiece, came as a result of a big bang or a big explosion? Well, you think about this as you look at God's Word here. Think about our Earth itself. You may not know that you're traveling, but think about the world itself. The Earth is traveling around on its own axis at 1,000 miles per hour. That's astronomical to me, that it's turning at 1,000 miles an hour. And so we're on a spaceship right now tonight without even knowing it. It travels around the sun every 365 days at the speed, now think about this, of 67,000 miles per hour. I don't have to go to Indy 500 to have fun. I'm having fun right now. I'm going 67,000 miles an hour right now around the sun. Did you know that? Have you ever thought about that? You said, well, I'm not conscious of that. Well, have you ever gotten on the jet? You get on the jet, you're conscious of its speed as it's taking off, but once you get in the air, you can't tell you're moving. And that's kind of how we are on this piece of transportation that we're traveling on tonight called this Earth. It's moving at 67,000 miles per hour as it makes its circuit around the sun every 365 days. It is carried by the sun to the galaxy at 64,000 miles per hour. It moves through orbit around our galaxy at 481,000 miles per hour. It travels through space at 350,000 miles per hour. And every 24 hours, do you know this? Now, you may never have known this. You think you're traveling. My wife and I took off to go to Niagara Falls, went down to Gettysburg, came home, and I was astounded because we'd go about 1,300 miles in just that two-day trip, okay? But what you don't realize is, now think about this, every 24 hours, as a human being, we cover 57,360,000 miles. Amen? And we're not even aware of it. I mean, isn't that an amazing thing what God created when He created this universe? Each year, we travel, and I'll have to get the number right here because I think it's trillion. Every year, we travel 20,936,400,000,000 miles. You think you're not a frequent flyer, amen? When you think about this. So this is the universe that God created. This is the universe God created. So, you know, if you don't think you're on the move, you're on the move. Amen? Because God created this universe and He created these celestial bodies. And look at the purpose, and I'm going to wrap up with this tonight. The Bible says when He created them, He said, let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. In other words, the very time things that we think about as times was created by God and was created for His purpose and ultimately for His glory. What about you tonight? Do you know God? Do you have a relationship with Him? I'm glad that we can know Him, and I'm glad that He has revealed Himself to us and that we can understand His creation. We can understand His eternal power and His Godhead by the things that He's made. And that will cause us to worship, amen, and to give Him honor and to give Him glory and give Him praise for who He is. Well, we're going to close there tonight with a word of prayer. Father, we thank You so much for the time we've had to hear some great singing tonight, to worship You in song. But then, Lord, just to open the Word of God for a little while this evening and to wonder over Your wonderful creation. Lord, we thank You for who You made and what You made. And Lord, I think of Your Word when it says that we are His people and the sheep of His pasture. It is He that has made us and not we ourselves. Lord, we thank You that You are the Creator. You're the one that made us, and we are fearfully and wonderfully made, as David said in Psalm 139. I pray, dear God, tonight there be even one here tonight that does not know You in a personal way. I pray, dear God, that tonight would be the time of salvation. We pray it all, and we ask it in Jesus' name, and for His sake we pray. Amen. Let's stand together for a closing song as the pianist comes. Mary, maybe there's something on your heart.